on the agenda. We have a couple of administrative things to talk about briefly. Then there are four matters on for public hearing. One that is noticed for 7:15, which I intend to start with at 7:15, or thereabouts. Three that are continued. One of those that's continued, I understand, 213 Hayden Row is withdrawing. So I will take that up. Just give me a couple minutes to get the other administrative stuff out, and we'll get you done, and then we'll move on through the list. So I think it'll be administrative, 213, the one that's noticed for 7:15 is 8 Downey, then 61 Main Street, the CVS matter, and then we will wrap up with 59 Wood Learning Center appeal, just to give folks an idea of where I'm aiming at. All right, so minutes, I guess, is next. Do we have any? Okay. How are we on the...
There are a process that was waiting to be sent out before the meeting was not the day before
the
meeting.
Okay. Well, we'll hit them then next time. Administrative items, I don't see anything listed. That last one is wrapped up, right? The request for release.
We're still waiting.
Okay, you just took it off. That's fine.
That's good. That's a good thing.
That's fine. Okay, then, unless there are any other administrative items, anything, then let's jump into the continued hearing for 213 Hayden Row.
Thanks, Mr. Davies. I'm pleased to advise the board that the building inspector has looked at the property and is satisfied with the actions taken by the owner to bring the property into compliance, and he has issued a release and withdrawal of the cease and desist order, thereby rendering this appeal moot, and therefore the appellant respectfully requests permission to withdraw the appeal without prejudice.
Okay, thank you. And I have that that withdrawal of the cease and desist in my hand, and I also see your request to withdraw the matter. So I think, unless someone tells me otherwise, we have everything we need. And if there's a motion,
I move to accept the withdrawal without prejudice.
Second.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed. So the motion carries, and the appeal is withdrawn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Davies. Would that it were all so easy. Okay. Now we have 5 minutes until we can formally call the 8 Downey Street matter.
Okay.
Is someone here for 59 Wood?
Yes.
Okay. Just wondering if council
yes.
for that. Okay, great. Just wanted to be sure who to look at once we got to it. Thank you. Thank you. just to get you up to speed, we're waiting for 7:15 for the 8 Downey Street, and then you'll be up. Folks, with apologies for the delay, the clock right in front of me says 7:15, so I'm going to call the 8 Downey Street matter. The Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing on Wednesday, October 14th, 2015 at 7:15 p.m. in the Hopkinton Town Hall to hear all persons interested in the application for special permit variance filed by Jeffrey Roby, 8 Downey Street, Hopkinton, Mass. The applicant seeks relief from the Hopkinton zoning bylaws to construct a new deck that does not meet the minimum setback requirements on property located at 8 Downey Street, Hopkinton, Mass. Application available for review at the Department of Land Use at Town Hall during office hours. So, Mr. Roby, are you here? Please step up and, if you would, describe to us what you want to do.
Removal of the existing deck and the expansion of the width of the deck from 13 feet to 33 feet.
And I understand that's the width of the deck, not the depth further out.
No, not further out at all. It was previously approved by the Conservation Commission, but the permit expired, so I had to refile.
Okay, and I see in the file that as of September 25th, 2015, the Conservation Commission did send you another letter saying that they had approved the site work subject to the specifications and the application you submitted to us.
Yes.
Okay. Unless you have anything else you want to offer, why don't I ask the members of the board if they have any questions for you, and then we can move forward.
Don't.
No?
No?
No? Mike?
As I understand the plan, sir, that the depth of the deck remains 10 feet.
Correct? Yes.
Okay. And so the extension will be essentially the equivalent of extension of the farthest reach of the deck running exactly parallel to the back of your house?
Correct.
Nothing more, Mr. Chair.
And I have nothing more. So, discussion? Let me move to motion to close. Fair enough. Thank you. Are there any neighbors? Anyone who wants to speak on this?
May I ask one more question?
Certainly.
Did you have to actually have, when you went to conservation, did you have an actual hearing, or was it a noticed hearing and here before the board?
This was about 12 years ago or so. I can't remember.
No, but didn't you just...
I originally had plans for the expansion of the house, and I guess I neglected to include the deck. And at that point, in 2000, Conservation Commission had my request for expansion of the deck, but it didn't go through the building department. So they approved it, but that's expired.
But you
that's
didn't,
why I refiled.
You didn't interact with them this year with that generated this letter beyond
this year
the written document.
So that's what I say. You have a letter from the Conservation Commission dated 25 September.
Yes.
Said that they received a copy of your application.
Yes.
So.
And they sent me a letter stating that I would have to refile with the building department to have the deck approved, and then they would approve the permit for the deck, for the setback.
But it was just recently reviewed by Mr. McAdams.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Nothing further, Mr. Chairman.
All right. And with that, I'd entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
I move to close the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. None opposed? Public hearing's closed. Any discussion?
I'd like to move the item based upon the plan that the petitioner supplied. You can see that this almost looks like the type of situation where the bylaw was drafted to allow for case of irregular, narrower, shallower lots. And I think that, as the petitioner pointed out, had his rear lot line been parallel to the house, he could have done this with no modification. But because the setback narrows, and because the deck is extending no closer to the lake than previously, and in fact, from looking at the prior Conservation Commission decision, that the deck and the house not get closer than 50 feet to the lake. The only, the staff is going to know what I'm going to say here. The drafting of the plan, in fairness, is apparently drafted by the petitioner. And so there are dimensions of how far the deck is to the edge of the lake and how far it will be after it's built. I mean, these plans do not suggest that the new addition gets any closer than the 50 feet that was required, but I'm persuaded by the fact that Mr. McAdams looked at these plans and was obviously aware of the prior decision by the Conservation Commission that no construction back there get closer than 50 feet. I would defer to Mr. McAdams' expertise in evaluating whether this was an issue or not. So in the normal case, as my staff is aware, I would prefer to have engineered plans. But under those circumstances, and because this is a deck and not a new building, I'm prepared to support the item and move it and determine that it meets the requirements for a special permit under 210-119.
Thank you. I think we take that as one good motion. Is there a second?
I second that.
All right. Any discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Usual conditions to land that it's consistent with the plan.
Right. So, not opposed. The motion carries. Mr. Roby, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Speak to staff.
You'll have to speak to staff, but the decision will be written once it's available and filed with the town clerk. Then you'll have to have it recorded.
And refile with the building department?
No, you'll have to have it recorded with the registry of deeds, but staff will walk you through what you need to do. Then with that, let us turn to the continued public hearing for 61 Main Street. When we had left off, we had previously addressed the standing issue with all parties. Then we had addressed the principal presentations of counsel for both sides on the merits and held our questions of the counsel so that we could get the public comments in, which we did. So I believe we are now up to questions from the board for the council on both sides on the merits. Yes, you recused, so thank you.
Thanks for stopping by.
Mr. Goldberg, I think as the burden's on you, as I indicated last time, I'm going to give you a chance to wrap up at the end, so we can start with you, or we can let you do it all in one at the end. Your choice.
I'm happy to answer any questions that the board has. Obviously, I do have some points in rebuttal to the statements and arguments of Cross Points Council that I'm going to pass through. I don't want to take very much time with it, but they're important points that just want to clarify.
Chairman, may I ask a question of clarification? This caused me to think of something that I thought about earlier today. Are we Is everybody in the room, everybody that the attorneys that represent all the parties? Mr. Grillberg used a phrase, and I'm trying to understand who represents who. I have a sense of who Mr. Grillberg represents based upon the plaintiff's appellants in this action. Through you, Mr. Chairman, may I ask, for the attorneys that have made the presentation the last time and are presenting tonight, are you representing Crosspoint? Are you representing CVS? Are you representing both? It would help me understand as to who represents whom in this matter.
So Benjamin Timon and Chris Kizzy, we represent only Crosspoint. We're co-counsel for Crosspoint Associates. We don't represent CVS.
And is anybody who's presented this during this whole time, have they? Has anybody represented CVS?
No.
Not me.
That might be difficult. Does that clear everything up, such as it is?
I'll hold any other discussion for that.
Okay, then why don't we do it this way? Why don't we ask questions of you first on the merits, then we'll turn to Crosspoint, and then I'll give you, a short amount of time to wrap up.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, any questions from the board or Mr. Goldberg, counsel for Pilat et al.?
I'll wait until everybody talks.
Yes?
I'll offer a question.
Please.
So we're focusing on the meaning of the bylaw and the Zoning Advisory Committee and the building inspector talked about the fact that they never meant to exclude pharmacies.
Yep.
Do you have any evidence to the contrary from always represented so far?
Well, I don't have anything to point to that would suggest that they would have intended or wouldn't have intended. I think that from the planning board meeting minutes that I'm aware of that were part of the package, what appears to have occurred based on the minutes, I can't go beyond the face of the minutes, but what appears to have occurred in the minutes is a determination at the time that the bylaw was under consideration for amendment to have the medical facility definition evolved, consistent with the way folks perceived the delivery of health services evolved, and to capture within facilities, within areas of the town that may not have been serviced by such facilities, a variety of different uses. I think the answer to the question is whether it was intended or not, in my view, respectfully, the decision captures, the definition as it stands, captures a pharmacy use because it falls within the catch-all of services that support the delivery of medical services and health services. Whether it was intended to or not at the time, we're here today because the way that bylaw exists today captures a particular use. If they didn't intend it to, but it does today, which forces us all here to bring this issue before this board for interpretation, then I would suggest it ought to be rewritten to reflect what the folks may have intended back then. But that's a legislative process. And the only thing that we can do now is to ask this board to interpret whether it does or it doesn't. And for the reasons we've argued, we say it does.
I'll wait on other things.
Okay. Any questions?
I have one question. I'm just trying to figure out the best way to word it. You brought up a bill, a House bill, that currently exists, the House bill number 2041. You brought this up last week. Do you know the status of that bill?
I don't.
It looked like there was a hearing recently, but I don't know.
I don't know. I tried to do whatever research I could on the status of it before, in preparation for appearing here. All I know is that it was still, that it was under consideration but not yet promulgated. I don't know beyond that.
Right, so it's not the law yet. I was reading through the statute that it affects, the two statutes that it affects, and it talks about collaborative drug therapy management and collaborative practice agreements that pharmacists would enter into. And I'm not in the healthcare business, so I don't understand what all this means. But it sounds like from the statute that it's a different certification or expertise that a pharmacist would have? It's not every pharmacist would have this status.
I wish I knew more about it, but the point of referencing the statute was to show that, you know, even in the circles of what's going on in at the state level, that a pharmacy is being recognized to be something more than simply the sale of prescription medications to somebody, that it is in fact part of the delivery of health services. And the definition under consideration is to broaden the definition and to recognize that pharmacy is something more and different. And that's the point of why that was raised in the papers.
And for certain, it seems very limited in scope, though. And that was kind of my question.
I had a question or two. In your most recent filing,
yes,
which is the one dated October 13th, I'm trying to understand something in your initial statement. We assert that the board should not characterize as a pharmacy use, reportedly generating over 70% of the site's revenue as incidental and subordinate and thus accessory to a general retail use, generating less than 30% of the site's revenue. I couldn't remember as to whether or not there was a presentation supported by Crosspoint, and I presume Crosspoint is up to date with what their tenant proposes to do, although I don't know that. So where did you get the numbers that this particular facility that is going to be located here based upon this building permit, since it isn't even open, anticipates that 70% of its total revenues will be for pharmacy, which I'm not sure even what pharmacy means. I would assume that in the general it means the drugs that we all buy in the little packages that come prepackaged. But this is a building that isn't even open yet. So where did you get the numbers of 70-30?
Certainly. Those numbers are coming straight from, and this is one of the points I would propose to have made later on in the rebuttal, but I'm happy to do it now.
For sure.
Those numbers come straight from CVS Health's 10-K filing annual report for 2014, which I believe is part of your packet, and if it's not, I'll hand it up. But the point is this, and your question is a fair one. I can't predict what this particular store at this location is going to do revenue-wise. What I can do, and what I think is fair to do for purposes of the hearing, is for this board to understand what CVS is reporting to its regulatory authorities of what its business is system-wide. So in CVS Health's, I mean, let's be fair, CVS Health's 10-K filing, CVS Health reports that CVS Pharmacy, Inc., the tenant, is what CVS Health calls in Exhibit 21 to its 10-K CVS Pharmacy, Inc., it's one of the listed subsidiaries of the registrant. In a footnote, it says CVS Pharmacy, Inc. is the immediate or indirect parent of approximately 45 entities that operate drugstores, all of which are in the United States and its territories. And it says, as of December 31st, 2014, CVS Health Corporation had the following significant subsidiaries. So let's understand the shell game that they're playing. The tenant may be CVS Pharmacy, Inc., but CVS Health is reporting on its corporate profile system-wide, company-wide, to the SEC. And part of what it's reporting are the revenues for its entire CVS Pharmacy division. And what CVS Health is reporting to the SEC is, in the section, and this is important, it's in the section of the 10-K where they are specifically reporting on, now, they're going to, it's the retail pharmacy division. That's how CVS Health characterizes this particular segment of the business. They talk about three segments, the retail pharmacy segment, but let's not be confused by that, a corporate segment and another sort of segment that's not relevant to these discussions. What is relevant is what the company is reporting for its CVS pharmacy store business, and that's what we're talking about. And it's in the section of the 10K that talks about only this division. Retail pharmacy segment net revenues by major product group are as follows. And it's reporting percentage of net revenues for its CVS pharmacy division. The subsidiary that does this business, that CVS Health as the mothership, is reporting in its 10K. That's where the numbers come from. It says prescription drugs for 2014, 70.7% of net revenue. Over-the-counter personal care, 11%, beauty cosmetics, 4.7%, general merchandise.
Can I have the phrase again, the first phrase?
I'm sorry, sure. I apologize for going too fast.
That's all right. You were requested to go fast. So.
Prescription drugs.
Thank you. That's what I need to know.
Prescription drugs, 2014, 70.7%. Over-the-counter and personal care, so non-prescription, non-pharmacy counter stuff, 11.0%. Beauty cosmetics, again, non-pharmacy, general retail stuff, 4.7%. General merchandise and other, 13.6%. So CVS Health, reporting to the SEC in the 10K, is telling the government that this is what our CVS pharmacy store business is. Over 70% of its business is being generated behind the pharmacy counter. Less than 30% of its business is being generated in the other 8,000 square feet. And just to drive the point home one step further, what I read off last time, and I won't do it again, although I'd like to, but what I read off last time are the quotes from the executives who are telling the world that we're at 70% pharmacy business now. By design, we're going up. And the retail, the general retail merchandise in the other 8,000 square feet that we're hoping people walk through is going down by design. That's where this comes from.
Thanks. That's responsible. I appreciate it.
Any further?
I'm sure if I thought about it, I could come up with further. But
well, let me give you a couple minutes for that.
Yes, I appreciate it.
So I have a couple questions as well. I think first, when we were speaking about the definition before, you presented on the definition, there were some elements of the definition that I recall you saying that that CVS did not meet, that you didn't have any qualms that they didn't meet certain elements of the definition.
Outpatient surgery.
Okay. My question is, are there any other aspects of the definition that you would agree that they don't meet so that we can focus on the ones that are in question?
Talk like that.
If you give me 1 second.
I'm sure we can leave off the section that's excluded in the definition.
Just that first sentence is the one we're all focused on.
Yeah.
In other words,
well,
anything to do with it.
I just wanted to go back to my outline from before because. So it's not a hospital. I mean, ignoring the obvious here.
Well, we can leave off the sections that are, by the definition, not included. So yeah, let's look at the first sentence first, I guess. Okay. So we're in agreement on outpatient surgery.
I would suggest going, well, what I said previously was that part of the definition is to dispense health services for health needs. I suggest that screening for drug interactions and allergies, patient counseling on prescription drugs, over-the-counter medication for patients, drug interactions, counseling of patients, and so forth. That's the dispensing of health services for health maintenance, I would argue. Your definition includes outpatient treatment of medical and physical conditions. One of the things I said last week was that, among other things, pharmacists under their license are permitted to provide nicotine addiction counseling, emergency contraception, vaccinations. These are things that a pharmacist can do not within the MinuteClinic, which we know isn't part of this, but as part of the pharmacy. Pharmacists can do these things. Now, I don't know if these pharmacists will, but under their licensing, they're permitted to. And it's reasonable to believe that a pharmacy, you know, a licensed pharmacist is going to provide the full panoply of services that a pharmacy can provide. So I would argue that contraception, counseling, vaccinations, those sorts of things would fit within the definition of outpatient treatment of medical and physical conditions. I would argue that the filling of prescriptions, coordinating with doctors' offices, health insurance companies, that's part of providing support to the medical profession and patients. Keeping confidential records, being a mandatory reporter for the patient. And then we get to the last part of the definition, which is other miscellaneous types of medical supplies and services. It's a catch-all. And it's a catch-all that captures, I suggest, the broad range of what a licensed pharmacist can do. To go back to your question, Ms. Clark, if this isn't what was intended when the bylaw was amended, and you know, there's a suggestion here that just the title was changed. Well, more than just the title was changed. The language was tinkered with. But if it wasn't recognized at the time that a broad-based licensed pharmacist can do any number of these things and fit within the definition, it's unfortunate that it wasn't contemplated, but here we are. I think fairly that what a pharmacist can do under its license fits within all of those different aspects of the definition.
Okay, thank you. One piece of the first sentence that I'm not sure I quite caught, I heard your point on treatment. Would you contend that diagnosis is within that as well?
I wouldn't suggest, well, I guess in my, I'm not sure I would say that pharmacists can diagnose a medical condition, but Mr. Pierce, to respond to one of the issues you raised last week, just anecdotally, I've had the occasion of a pharmacist denying me a prescription for one of my kids because their system flagged an interaction between medications, either an interaction, a negative interaction between medications that my kids are taking, or an issue in terms of dosage. So I personally, in my own experience, have had a pharmacist tell me, I'm not giving you this medication, go talk to your doctor. So I wouldn't say that a pharmacist can diagnose a medical condition. I think an MD can do that.
I just wanted to understand where we stood on each of the points. You touched on the last piece, the other miscellaneous types of medical supplies and services. And I understand your position is that the CVS would be doing that, correct?
Yes.
Okay. I would direct you to the beginning of that clause that says may include establishment. Let me get your thoughts on how that fits into it, because as I read it, this is not something that says that all establishments that provide miscellaneous types of medical supplies and services are within this definition. I think they have to meet the first sentence that we spoke about earlier, and then the second clause of the second sentence provides some examples of it, but it doesn't say that everything that's listed there is necessarily in. And I think, to my view, the catch-all is probably where the may is supposed to focus. So I'd be interested in your views on that.
I think what that is suggesting is that a health services facility a provider of services fits within the definition of a health services facility if it can meet any of these things. It may include. Now, it's not suggesting that to be a health services facility, it must have one or more of these things. But the providing of any one of these services would fit within the definition of a health services facility. What I'm saying is, perhaps inartfully, is that it is the providing of of the type of service, which is captured by this definition, which then would require, I think, the board to characterize it as a health services facility. Does it provide support for medical professional patients? Well, health services facility may do that. And if it does, it's a health services facility. A health services facility may do any number of other things if it fits within this definition. It's a health services facility.
Well, I think, again, as I would say that from my view, this, with all due respect to the folks that wrote this and the town meeting that voted it in, it's not the greatest example of drafting in some aspects.
Oh.
with respect to the gentleman to my right.
By the way, some of us have jobs.
That said, so
that's brutal.
As I view it, you know, to fall within this definition, the first sentence has to be satisfied. In the second sentence, it exemplifies things that are not exempted from falling within this definition in the first clause. I think that's clear. And then the second clause says that the definition may, but does not necessarily, include the rest of that second sentence.
If what you're suggesting is that any of these things under may can be there, but it's not a health services facility, I disagree if that's what you're getting at. Because I would suggest to you that it's the opposite, that a health services facility, let's look at the first sentence. It's a building that contains establishments dispensing health services for health maintenance and the outpatient diagnosis and treatment medical, dental, and physical. I don't think it has to be all of those things. It can be some of them and still fit within the definition of a health services facility. It can be other things. A building that contains other types of services in support of the delivery of health care is a health services facility. It can be any number of things. It may be A, B, C, or D. It doesn't have to be, but it may be. And if it is, it's a health services facility under this definition.
Let me give you an example that occurred to me. So let's say an accountant specializes in providing accounting services to doctor's offices, and that's all they do. They are clearly providing support to the medical profession. Is that accountant's office a health services facility under this definition?
I would suggest it's not, because it's not providing a service that goes to the delivery of health care. It's providing accounting service. A pharmacist is not an accountant. A pharmacist is providing a service that is directly and intimately connected with the delivery of health care in support of the medical care provided by a doctor.
Fair enough, but then there can be establishments that are listed within this may include section that you agree don't fall within the definition.
I'm sorry, say that again?
So it says may include establishments providing support to the medical profession. And it exemplifies some types of those establishments, such as medical and dental labs, blood banks, etc. But
that's not an exhaustive list.
I would agree it's not an exhaustive list, but what I'm suggesting is it also says may include, and not all of the things within that definition appear to be within the definition of health services facility.
A facility providing oxygen, by definition, would fit within the definition of a health services facility. A building that contains a service delivering oxygen would fit within this definition and be captured by it. The way this is drafted. I mean, thankfully, I'm not on your side of the table. But the way this is drafted, I would suggest, is really broad. For good or for worse, it is what it is. This is what we have to work with. And the language that you're focusing on, the may and the such as, those are not words of exclusion. Those are words of inclusion. And only by example. So it's a non-exhaustive list. Other things that are not listed here can be captured by the definition. And all of
these
that you suggested, pharmacy fits within that catch-all.
Okay. Thank you for your view on that. But I have one other
item I just wanted to touch on, and that's, you know, we have to confine our decision to interpreting this in our zoning bylaw in light of the statutes. So I did just have a look at the Massachusetts statutes for how they define pharmacy. And there is a definition of pharmacy in Chapter 94C, Section 1, that includes within its scope retail drug businesses, as they're defined here. And retail drug businesses are a store for the transaction of drug business as defined in the Registration of Occupations Act. I don't mean to suggest this is dispositive on this issue, but I was wondering if you had any thoughts about that. I was struck by the fact that it does describe the store of business as a retail drug business.
I think it's not inconsistent because this town, again, has its own definition of uses that fit in certain districts. One of those definitions is health service facility. And notwithstanding what you're pointing to, if a pharmacy use fits, if this board determines that a pharmacy use fits within the definition of the health services facility, which we suggest the board shouldn't, but if the board does, then it is captured within a defined use that is not among the enumerated uses allowed within the downtown business district. And if not allowed by right and not allowed by special permit, it is prohibited as a matter of town bylaw.
Fair enough. But in your presentation last week, you suggested that even if a pharmacy, this particular pharmacy, I'll confine it to, did not fall within health services facility, that you still felt that you had an argument with respect to pharmacy that was separate from the healthcare facility.
I do, because the pharmacy use, the delivery of services that a licensed pharmacist provides, goes beyond the mere sale of medication. And the issue is whether the non-retail pharmacy use is accessory or primary. And I would suggest that based on the revenue numbers that are reported by CVS Health on behalf of its subsidiary, CVS Pharmacy Inc., 70 to 80+% of the business being generated by that store is being driven by the pharmacy use and not the general retail use.
Thank you. Mike, have I given you enough time?
Yeah. And
can I just ask a follow-up?
Sure.
So you just listed the functions of the licensed pharmacist, and at Hopkinton Drug, do those licensed pharmacists provide all those same services that you anticipate at the CVS?
I imagine the licensed pharmacists at Hopkinton Drug do whatever licensed pharmacists are permitted to do. I don't know the intimate details of Hopkinton Drug's business, but it's not particularly relevant because Hopkinton Drug has been existing in the downtown business district for decades. So the issue at hand affects not Hopkinton Drug, but CVS, or the proposed use of the existing space for CVS Pharmacy Inc.
Okay, that's it.
I think you're right that at least it's quite possible that Hopkinton Drug has been here for a long time. Mr. Shepherd, to people that have lived in this town much longer than I, since 1997, could educate me, but I assume that it didn't come in 1996. And it certainly was there a long time in 2012 when the Zoning Amendment Committee considered these modifications, when the Planning Board considered these modifications, and the town meeting considered these modifications. Have you had an opportunity to review the materials that were filed on behalf of Crosspoint and CVS, which included the minutes, such as they are, of the Zoning Amendment Committee and the Planning Board when those items were evaluated and voted to go from Zoning Amendment Committee to the Planning Board and Planning Board to the town meeting?
I did review Crosspoint's submittal. I'm most familiar in my head with the meeting minutes that are attached to our papers, which talk about the basis for the decision made to change the definition and amend the bylaw.
Talking about the same thing. Okay. So just to have you on the record, so with your own statement that you perceive and your knowledge is, if it's anecdotal or historical, that Hopkin and Drug had been in the center of town for a long time before this change of this title and the, which we'll talk about in deliberation, modest changes in the definition of this facility. Is it fair to say that you'd agree that the people on the Zoning Amendment Committee and the Planning Board, and even merely a fair number of the people at town meeting, were aware that Hopkin and Drug previously existed?
I would imagine so.
I would imagine so, too, since I was on the board. And so are you suggesting that, for the purpose of your argument, that inadvertently, at the least, or at the most, and intentionally, that these modifications were designed to render Hopkin and Drug a legal nonconforming use, since I think you'd agree that Hopkin and Drug has a pharmacy and therefore would have licensed pharmacists and therefore would have the ability to do the same things that you're suggesting that a licensed pharmacist can do if the CVS opens? And so are you suggesting that either first that intentionally these various boards and the town decided to make one of the cornerstone locations of the downtown business district a legal nonconforming use? It's a two-part question, so do you think they intentionally decided to do that?
I think it would be somewhat arrogant of me to try to conceive of what was deliberate or non-deliberate. I don't mean to suggest that there was, quite frankly, I'm in no position to suggest what may have been deliberated at the time or not. I can only go by the minutes in front of me, and it's speculation on my part. I can only speculate as to what, may or may not have been intended. I believe Mr. Shepard may have indicated last week that pharmacists didn't come up in the discussion. I may have that wrong. I apologize if I do. But I don't believe, I have the minutes in front of me. There's no mention of pharmacy. So I'm having difficulty answering your question, Mr. Pierce, because I don't mean to, there's no way for me to get in the head of what the folks were thinking at the time. I guess I would answer it this way, that changes to the bylaw happen all the time. Bylaws are amended in a variety of ways over the course of time, and the result of those amendments is that it gives rise to what then become pre-existing non-conforming uses. That happens all the time. That's why there's protection to pre-existing non-conforming uses. I imagine it's undesirable because zoning loathes nonconformity. Zoning wants things to be conforming and loathes nonconformity. But it nonetheless happens. And if the net result of this board's decision, if this board were to decide that a pharmacy is in fact a health services facility, and if that has the effect of rendering Hopkinton Drug, formally speaking, a nonconforming use, then so be it. But I don't mean to suggest that that was intended or not intended, but that may very well be, well, that would be, I suppose, the net result if this board finds in favor of my client's petition.
Based upon your reading of the various minutes, as I said, it was a two-part question, did you see anything in your reading of those minutes that appeared that was something that was understood, contemplated, or intended?
No.
Okay. So your major argument is that it may have been the inadvertent result, if we should make that decision.
It would be inadvertent.
If they didn't intend it, then presumably it's inadvertent.
I can't stand before you and say it was by deliberate design.
Okay. I don't want to have any more.
As I said, we'll certainly give you a short time to wrap up at the end, but let's turn to Cross Point then. I know you split up your time earlier, but you're both welcome to come.
I want to ask questions. Do you mind? That's why I'm the chairman.
Not at all. You want a bad opinion?
I'd like to start a couple of them.
Good evening, members of the board.
Good evening. Council, to follow up on something that just occurred to me at the beginning of the meeting, and focusing on the fact, and some of this may be privileged, so don't answer this question. Not that I need to tell you to not answer privileged questions. But you've indicated that you represent the landlord.
Correct.
In this matter. In presenting your position here, and again, maybe you can't answer this question, was it primarily based upon your assessment of the materials that you filed and your legal analysis of the wording of the changed bylaw definition? Or can you give me any sense of how much it is key to what you understand your tenant to be proposing to how your tenant is proposing to operate?
Sure. One of the things we included in our submittal was an affidavit from John Huber with respect to the lease between Cross Point and CVS Pharmacy, Inc. And that lease dictates exactly what CVS can and cannot do at this location. And so if I could just for a minute read from that. Mm-hmm. What the lease permits CVS to do, or the way in which it permits CVS to use the property, is specifically the following. A retail store for the display and sale of health and beauty aids, non-prescription drugs, cosmetics, perfumes, food and beverage items for off-premises consumption, stationery, office supplies, books, newspapers, magazines, greeting cards, including but not limited to Hallmark and/or American Greetings, cameras, off and on premises, photo processing services, including 1-hour service, digital service, medical supplies, durable medical equipment, audio tapes, videotapes, CDs, DVDs, lottery tickets, hardware, housewares, toys, automotive supplies, and such other items or services as are from time to time sold or provided by CVS or other drugstores, including the right to operate a pharmacy prescription department and/or a video sales and rental department, all subject to applicable laws. So that is the universe of things that CVS may do at this location. As the board knows, a Minute Clinic is not among, at least currently, the permissible uses unless there were to be some additional approval granted by the town. There's not going to be a Minute Clinic at this location.
I want to phrase correctly. To your knowledge, does your client lease to any other generic, I'll call it generic drugstores, such as CVS, Rite Aid, or anything like that? To your knowledge?
Well, Mr. Huber is nodding, so yes. I mean, I can consult with him if you'd like more information on that topic.
Point is that arguably,
it's a course of dealing and understanding in these types of facilities, yes.
Did either of you draft this lease?
I believe that's a great question. I think my office, I personally did not have, I was not the one who drafted it. It may have been my office that drafted the lease. Is that? Okay, no, it was not.
So you don't know if you've used this language in prior things or not?
I don't know that, the answer to that question.
That was my first. I just wanted to get that out of the way. I may well wish to circle back.
We take it from the other side. Anything?
No.
Okay. Fair enough. No?
No.
Nope. Okay. I'll give you a break for a few minutes.
Please.
So what I'd like to do is, again, take a look at the definition of health service facility, since that's the main focus of the appeal.
Sure.
Though, as I understand, not the only focus. And get your position on which aspects you would agree CVS would do and which your contention would be CVS wouldn't do. So let's take the first sentence, for example, and we can leave out outpatient surgery because I understand that's not contended. But any other parts of that definition that you would contend that this particular CVS location is not going to be doing?
So in my opinion, I don't think CVS will be doing any of it. And I would point out that the definition lists these various uses by using the word and not or. So it's health services for health maintenance and the outpatient diagnosis and treatment of medical, dental, and physical conditions, including outpatient surgery. The most glaring of which, I think that categorically could be eliminated, is the outpatient diagnosis and treatment. I mean, there's absolutely no outpatient diagnosis and treatment that is going to happen at this CVS. And to suggest that giving advice on how to use a prescription drug or drug interactions or dispensing contraception is diagnosis and treatment, I think, is completely stretching, if you will, the definition of this term.
Well, leaving aside the and for a second, you would certainly agree, I would imagine, that administering a vaccine is treatment of some sort of medical condition. Would you agree with that?
It's preventative. I don't know if it's treatment per se. I mean, when I think of diagnosis and treatment, I think of go to your doctor tells you you have a certain condition and that you need to take X, Y, and Z medication to treat that condition. I don't think that's happening. Unquestionably, I don't think that's happening at CVS. And the broad interpretation, in fact, that's being advocated by the appellants, you know, I think it's a point worth making that medical offices are an allowed use in this district. And certainly there's diagnosis and treatment happening at a medical office, and there's a greater degree of health services being dispensed at a medical office. And if we're to now say that medical office, by their interpretation, would also be a health service facility. And so now you have a completely inconsistent
and I would agree
interpretation
with
of the bylaw.
I think I would agree with you that if that was the conclusion, that it would render render things quite complicated, because there are certainly zones where medical offices are permitted, as in the zone that is issue here, and health services facilities are not. So I don't, my personal view is that I don't think you can view health services facilities encompassing the definition of medical office, but I think we can consider that certainly. So with respect to the first piece, I understood your position that the ands are ands, and that means that all of the elements have to be satisfied, but health services for health maintenance, would you contend that CVS does not do that?
I would not contend that it's providing health services for health maintenance. It's selling prescription drugs. That is a retail sale, unquestionably, and all the information we heard about revenues generated by the sale of prescription drugs generally at various CVS locations, I would argue, underscores the fact that it's a retail sale that's happening. I don't view that as providing a health service for health maintenance. And whether or not that could generally be categorized as such, I don't think is relevant to whether or not, within the context of this bylaw definition, it falls within a health service for health maintenance. And this goes somewhat to the intent, and I don't want to get beyond your question, but.
Well, thank you. I guess moving to the second sentence and leaving aside the things that are clearly excluded from the definition, would you contend that this CVS is not going to provide support to the medical profession and patients?
You're looking at the section that says, but may include?
But may include. And I understand you may have issues with that phrasing as well, but...
You know, I would suppose in a very general, broad sense, you could argue that. But again, I don't view that as... I don't interpret this definition to mean that any establishment that potentially could be viewed as providing support to the medical profession would render that establishment a health service facility. Don't think, again, that's what it was intended, and I don't think that's how this reads.
Okay. I think there's not much argument about medical and dental labs, blood banks, and oxygen. I suppose I should ask, you know, to your knowledge, will CVS provide oxygen services through this location?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. And then the last part of the definition, the other miscellaneous types of medical supplies and services. Would it be your contention that CVS isn't going to do that, or that it may, or that it will? I'm just trying to understand your position.
Yeah, again, I don't think providing, you know, it will be selling what may be categorized as a medical supply. If there's some type of, you know, if you're looking for a brace of some kind for your knee, I guess selling that could be viewed as providing a medical supply. I don't think it's providing a medical service, but I think there are a lot of retail establishments that provide those types of products.
Okay. I think I know where you'll be on this, but you already spoke to the ands in the first sentence. What's your view on may include? The second sentence that has the may include piece. Would you view that as the items that are listed after the may include are necessarily within the definition or maybe within the definition?
I would agree that it's a may, so it may include those things. It won't in every instance include those uses.
Okay. Turning to the issue of the profits that were referenced from the 10K, you know, I understand the appellant's position, and I'm also sympathetic to a degree that they're trying to prove what this use will be when the building isn't fitted out and the tenant isn't operating yet. So it puts them in a difficult situation to prove exactly all of what's going to happen there. But understanding that you may contend it doesn't matter, would your position be that pharmacy sales will be a majority of the sales at this location based on that 10K? You don't know, or would you have any, you know, any point you can make? Do you dispute essentially that it's going to be at least a majority?
Well, I think it would be pure speculation for any of us to say exactly what the anticipated sales from the prescription medications will be at this pharmacy location and whether that will be the majority of retail sales. But I mean, I think you correctly anticipated my response that it's not relevant. I think we're hearing a lot about revenues generated by the sale of prescription medications, and I simply don't think it's relevant. It's all we've heard virtually nothing about any types of services that would be provided that would render this a health service other than giving a pharmacist providing advice or counseling on how to use medication, perhaps dispensing contraception or providing a vaccination. I mean, those are very limited categories. And I would argue that providing advice on how to use a product is a component of any retail sale. You know, I might go to a hardware store and ask them how to use, you know, what particular automotive type product I need for my car. That use doesn't become an automotive body shop or repair shop because I'm asking for that advice. So I think when you're talking about providing advice or counseling, it's again what's happening when you're going to the pharmacy department. The main thing that's happening is you're purchasing prescription medication, and that's retail. And I think whether it's quite frankly 70%, 50%, or 30% is totally irrelevant.
Okay. Thank you. I don't have anything further, so. Thank you.
Thank you.
I know last time, and I mentioned this at the outset, that we did take everyone from the public who had comments, and I'm mindful that I see many of the same faces here, but as this is a public hearing, if there is someone who is attending today who didn't have a chance to speak and would like to speak, again, confine this, as I said, please try to confine your comments to the legal issues that we're dealing with here with respect to the definition and whether this property is going to be used within the scope of its zoning, not personal preference about what might go there. But with that as a caveat, if anyone would like to, from the public, would like to comment, the podium is open.
Hi, I'm Darlene Hayes. I had a couple things on it being, it's not being pro-CVS or anti-CVS, is the whole health services thing. So if we take that anyone who could give medical advice in saying that, that includes yoga instructors, chiropractors, all these businesses we already have, are we going to say that I want new businesses coming into town? I don't want to have, I mean, a lot of the fitness centers or Curves, if I go to, I want them coming into town. Are we going to say that those are now against the law for these a new chiropractor to come in? They maybe all take my insurance card, and they're definitely giving me advice. Are we not going to let them in? Because they're going to provide health services. The other thing, when it was mentioned about vaccines and stuff, so if I go to the senior center for a flu shot, am I getting health services at the senior center? If I go there when there's medical lectures going on and getting advice that are provided by Hockington Drug or whoever might be providing it, am I getting then, you know, within medical advice there? If I go to the library for a lecture and they bring in a doctor who might be talking about breast cancer during breast cancer awareness, and that's all falling in here. I want businesses to be drawn in here, and whether it's, I mean, honestly, when Kohl's was there, I could buy a Band-Aid, I could buy booze, I could buy, you know, I could buy aspirin. A lot of the stuff that's already been there is still going back there. The only addition I see is a pharmacy that we already have and don't see what the big difference is. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else from the public? Okay. Seeing none, I'd like to turn to our town council and ask for his input on a couple of these issues. Chris, I know you've had an opportunity to review all the pleadings and have I'm sure you have some thoughts on the standing issue as well as the construction. So why don't I ask you for those for the benefit of the board?
Sure. Thank you. So I think the first main, I think, decision point for the board is the procedural question of, it was discussed at length last week, of the fact that one of the original elements for this matter has removed itself from the proceeding, and there are some additional appellants who assigned the application for join it. Both parties briefed extensively the question of whether that was something that's possible or not. I've reviewed the briefs from both sides. I have done a good amount of homework on my own to double-check their work on this question of adding in a new appellant. And I think the parties addressed this last week. There's no case that I've been able to find that's directly on point on that question. The appellant has cited several cases for the proposition that once an appeal is properly filed, there can be a motion to amend to add a new party after the original filing. Those cases are good as far as they go, but they all involve appeals filed under Chapter 48, Section 17 in court, and are all sort of governed by the rules of civil procedure, which are applicable once you get there. Now, interestingly, those cases do stand for the proposition that you need to file a 48, Section 17 appeal 20 days after the decision is filed with the town clerk. That deadline is usually a hard and fast deadline, but again, if there is a problem with one of the parties, a new party with standing has been allowed to come in more than 20 days. But again, not directly on point with what you've got in front of you right now, insofar as the rules of civil procedure don't apply here. Crosspoint, in rebuttal to those cases, has pointed to the 30-day deadline for appealing the issuance of a building permit under 40A sections 8 and 15. And cases that generally stress the importance of deadlines in the zoning context, which are, again, good case law as far as those cases go, but don't address the fact pattern here, which is that an appeal is timely filed, someone drops out, and someone else wants to come in after the fact. So we've got sort of two sets of cases, that none of which directly instruct you what you must do in this context. But I will say that looking at all of those cases, there is I've found no case that suggests that the substitution of the new set of parties for the original is impermissible as a matter of law. In no case, it absolutely cannot be done. And I think in the absence of a case directly on point, the board has to decide something, and the question is on what basis do you make that decision? And what I think I find most compelling is this. You must appeal the issuance of a building permit within 30 days of its issuance if you know about the issuance of that building permit. But as was discussed last week, notice is not provided to abutters or parties of interest when a building permit issues. Unlike this application, where everybody was notified, that notice is not sent out. Nonetheless, if you know about the issuance of the building permit, you must appeal within 30 days. If you don't know about the issuance of the building permit, you can, once you have actual notice of that issuance, ask the building commissioner to revoke the building permit, and then an appeal can follow from that decision. So here, one of the new parties that is looking to step into this appeal is one that we heard testimony about last week, was unaware of the issuance of the building permit. So technically, it appears, has another appeal of this matter available to him still, which is to say that if he didn't know about the building permit when it first issued, discovered it later, he can, and I think he has, provide some correspondence to the building commissioner's office and about this permit. And again, once a ruling is made on that letter, could theoretically file another appeal down the road, leaving the board in the sort of awkward position of, if it were to find that the new appellant could not step in, and this appeal, therefore, were dismissed or denied, that appellant could be back here in a month or 2 months with a new appeal on the exact same issues, and the board would be back in the exact same spot if I'm itself right now. So putting all that together, and looking for a solution in the absence of a directly controlling case, my suggestion, the best thing to do is the practical solution, which is to treat this new appellant as if it were part of this appeal, and therefore there would be no appeal down the road. We would not be back in the same place in a month or two. And to just sort of take that substitution as part of this original appeal.
Would it be your view that if we did add him, since the council is represented, that he would be representing him in this context?
Yes.
Right. So he would, having the decision made now with him in this appeal, would exhaust that possibility of him appealing again. At least,
yes, I think if the board were to accept that appellant now, it would be well within its rights to, if a new appeal were filed by the same person on the same issue, a month or 2 months or some time down the road from now, to reject that appeal on the grounds that it's already been heard, immediately and without any real substantive discussion of the application.
I think getting some certainty for everyone involved would be good. Do you have any views on the definition? We've discussed a bit tonight.
Well, as the chair knows, town council was asked to look at this definitional question a while back and issued a letter to the Board of Selectmen back in June.
And that letter is in the record.
That letter is part of the record submitted by, I forget if it was the appellant or the or Crosspoint, but it's but it is in the record before you, in which town council's office opined that this use is properly characterized as a retail use under the zoning bylaw. Now that was issued, that opinion was arrived at before this appeal was filed and before the public hearing was held and before all the briefs were put in, and I don't want to at this point the decision is one for the board, and I don't want to step on the board's decision making toes, but I think having heard all the evidence and all the arguments, I'm happy to answer any questions about the definition or any particular part of the definition or the case law that exists about retail use of pharmacies. So I guess I'd just stand pat there and be happy to answer any specific questions that anybody has.
Sure. And let me open it up. Any of the other board members have questions specifically for you?
Why would you start to ask them?
I'll let that be noted. No? Okay. Thank you very much. Then, as I said, since the appellants have the burden, I certainly give you a bit of time to wrap up. Because I don't want to step on anyone's toes and argue that there's been a procedural violation. Does Crosspoint feel it needs to sum up? I don't feel we necessarily need to hear more, but.
Mr. Chairman, if the board doesn't feel it's necessary, then we're going to follow your lead on that. I did want to, though, just as a housekeeping matter, make sure that the board had received into the record our letter dated today, in fact, quite late today, in response to Mr. Goldberg's letter of yesterday. Now that's, I want to also apologize because given that we did receive Mr. Goldberg's response yesterday, we wanted to provide a meaningful reply on both issues, and so it was not emailed to the town until after 5 today. And so I do have copies of it.
I think if you would hand those.
So just to ensure that the record is complete.
Thank you for that point, then.
I did CC Attorney Goldberg. Did you receive it, Attorney Goldberg?
At a quarter tonight on my drive here.
Well, as I said, we were.
So there's a big copy. If you have a copy for him as well, I'd
yes.
Yeah. That. So
that's fine there.
And Attorney Goldberg, if you'd like a minute or two to have a look before you saw him, I'm happy to give you that. So. Well, we can always change our rules.
So again, my apologies for it being received so late, but again, we did want to provide a comprehensive response to Attorney Goldberg's letter of yesterday that addressed two issues, one having to do with revenue, which I think has been amply treated tonight. I think the board seems to agree that that issue has been debated fully. And then the other issue does speak to, at least tangentially to what Attorney Heap just raised with respect to the prospective amendment. And really there in the first several pages of the letter just speaks to the issue of constructive notice, which I talked about last week a little bit, that it's not really a question of when Mr. Mahan actually knew that a building permit had been issued. He says it wasn't until the end of August, but that the case law makes clear that adequate notice under Chapter 48 for purposes of calculating appeal deadlines includes constructive notice, i.e. when should he have known, when should an abutter, who by the way is an attorney, I understand, so would have some baseline knowledge of the law, should have known that there was enough activity occurring next door to him to put him on what the case law time and time again describes as a duty of inquiry. So when was his duty of inquiry as to finding out exactly what town permits and approvals had been issued? And so in our letter, we provide some photographs of the construction that was taking place on the site throughout June and July, including the street being torn up, Grove Street being torn up right next to his house. We also provide a list of 14 different local press articles talking about CVS and the building permit. And I do believe that the board would have received yesterday a letter submitted, I understand, by the owners of the hot dog stand, where they attest, the Snappy Dogs hot dog stand, I think you do have that, where they attest to the day-in, day-out construction activity. So that's really what our letter was about, was to the issue of Mr. Mahan's constructive notice, his duty of inquiry, and therefore his inexcusable tardiness in filing his appeal.
Okay.
Small audience.
Small audience.
I won't characterize it as lowercase or capital. But.
All right. Well, thank you for clearing up the record. I appreciate that because you had not received this. But we will take it into consideration. Then if you have nothing further, then Attorney Goldberg.
I think, you know, both sides have done an admirable job of presenting the issues before the board. So I stand on what we've said and what we've written, and I leave it to this good board's decision. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hearing that, I would move the case.
I didn't know if you wanted a full copy of all the minutes of the planning board and zoning advisory committee. I had asked here before you moved on.
I think that from what I could tell, is there more there than was included in Bowers and Duty's filing?
I think there was an additional zoning advisory committee meeting.
Okay. There.
Then why don't you hand it up so that we receive it? If you could point us to which particular one was new, then we can have it focused on that.
The front, I just kind of took the excerpts out, but the entire minutes are attached. And I also included a couple of things that were mentioned.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you much. All right. And at the risk of asking, if there's nothing more, I would entertain a motion.
Move to close.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. None opposed? We've closed the public hearing.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank everyone for all their input. The board's now going to move to deliberate. I would hope we can discuss it and hopefully everyone should be prepared to reach late. I know we've had some late submissions. But we're prepared to vote tonight. I think we can certainly deal with that. But what's the sense of the board?
I think a lot of people are waiting to hear the determination of the overwhelming majority of the facts that have been presented. Which is not to denigrate either in the time that we will take to deliberate, if people want to take a look at something, I think we can do that. That's my question.
I would be prepared to vote.
Prepared to vote, John?
Yes.
And I would be as well. So let's deliberate. Anyone have any views they want to share?
What are we starting with the procedural or the permit?
Why don't we take it in the order we did? John, why don't we start with the standing and the submission to add the two the two appellants?
Listening to the town council's advice, bring this to a vote to include it, to end it, would be, in my opinion, a good way to go.
Yeah, I think his argument was persuasive, and I think voting on the merits tonight would be in the best interest.
I couldn't agree more. What motivates me to listening to Chris and recognizing that the cases are helpful but not directly on point. I think that the critical element here that was developed at the last meeting was the chronology, and one could say that if you want to be absolutely certain that your position is presented, you should sign on to any appeal if you're so motivated within the 30 days that you knew, whether you knew exactly or knew constructively. Hard to know if you know constructively. But as I understand it, if taking the testimony is correct, that the what I called last time to be sort of the statutorily aggrieved abutter stepped away with no time for somebody to be substituted within the 30 days, that I think it would be unfortunate and frankly inequitable to make a sort of very small c conservative determination that the appeal should fail, notwithstanding town council's point that it could restart. That's really not my motivation. I just think that the timing is people thought that they had the right number of people, they filed in the right amount of time, unbeknownst to people, after there was no time to substitute, the person, for whatever reason, stepped away. I think it would be inequitable to not allow another arguably statutorily aggrieved party to step in, and therefore I would recommend that on the jurisdictional question that we rule in favor of the appellants and determine that the appeal is properly before the board.
With the addition of the
yes.
two parties?
Yes.
Yeah. And I couldn't agree more. I think the cross-point admitted from my recollection that the appeal was timely filed with an abutter at that point. That abutter did withdraw after the deadline. But I would agree with you that it would be horribly inequitable. It would be, I think, a bad precedent to set up for ourselves to say that you have to sign up everybody possible for your appeal to try and avoid this situation. I appreciated Mr. Goldberg's submission of yesterday on equitable authority. Whether we have it or we don't, as has been argued, I think is perhaps a matter that a court may instruct us on if it's appealed. But as town council shared with us, and I think both parties' counsel candidly told us as well, there isn't a case directly on point on this matter. And I think under those circumstances, and in particular, given that there's at least an arguable question as to whether one of the parties that's seeking to be added had notice, but they're willing to be bound by this this case that's already been briefed up, argued well by both sides, and we can reach a decision, I think it would be terribly inequitable to not allow that rebuttal to add. I guess I have a question that we should discuss, and that's whether we should or need to specifically address whether any of the other abutters have standing, or one of the other issues that was raised, whether I should recall his name, the other abutter that seemed to be added was named his corporate capacity.
All right.
Or his personal capacity.
Chris, as a practical matter, I look to you as I can't anticipate appeals and things like that on either side. We could spend some time, to the extent that we should, discussing the other people that filed this, and we could discuss the issue of the other abutters, whether he's personal or corporate or whatever like that. I guess I'd be guided by you as to whether you think it's appropriate or necessary to get into a discussion like that. My experience has been that at the local level, that type of analysis is usually not engaged in. Because it sometimes is subject to deposition and things like that. We haven't questioned the people. There's been just this generic concept of you have to have this particularized agreement, which you can still have if you're not a direct abutter, but much harder to prove. My experience and my perception is that if that's something that came up in an appeal, that that would be the more appropriate place, but I'd be guided by you.
I think that's a good point, and so I have that one, and I think maybe one other. The parties are much better equipped to test each other's standing by the time you get to court with written discovery and depositions, as you said. Much better equipped than the board is to test those things without
any of that.
Any of those tools available to you, should you want to undertake that exercise. Second point is that jurisdictionally there only needs to be one abutter or one party with standing in order for the appeal to be properly heard. And it's my memory from the testimony that Carpenter was trying to keep one of the abutters out on sort of procedural grounds, but didn't directly challenge the standing on a factual basis, should be the last ground. So I think, as I read the evidence that was submitted, you've got your appellate there, and you don't necessarily need to find all of the remaining appellants have standing in order for you to go forward. The third point is that even if you did want to engage in the analysis of whether each remaining appellant has standing, that and there were to be an appeal, your finding on that point is not going to be entitled to the slightest bit of deference from the court. The court will redo that analysis all on its own with the benefit of all the discovery of the parties that have engaged in. So to me, you add all that up and come back to a factual solution of if the board finds that the direct abutter standing is in it does, I don't believe the board needs to review the standing of all of the remaining parties.
Mr. Chairman, do you feel that this is sort of a bifurcated thing and that there should be
I think that was me.
A vote on that or something, or is it just it's technically one of the grounds that I think was raised in objection. So whatever your pleasure is.
I think we should address it with a finding on that point, whether we do it as a separate motion first and then address it second. I don't think it matters.
Okay, so then why don't we move to my suggestion, move to the case in chief.
All right, then let's reverse again on the merits. Any thoughts?
Can I go second? I'm still thinking.
I'll switch back.
I'm good.
You're good?
My view is that, there's an intent to the bylaw that we always look at. And, I don't think the intent was to exclude pharmacies as a use in this district.
I have something to say.
Mike?
To work off that, there are so many legal principles here that I think are involved in terms of statutory construction and the like. If the statute is clear, then we just read the words. And I think we can talk about the words. And that's, I think, the chairman was focusing on that. And I think we can talk about that. If the words aren't clear, statutory construction is clear that you can actually attempt to divine some understanding by the legislative intent. That's what you were talking about. And so this is why I mentioned last week and again about whatever benefit there might be from the statutory legislative history. When I did this work in other communities that I didn't have the ability to sit on the board that talked about it, and I'm faced with the question of a building commissioner's interpretation of a bylaw, either in favor or against, because I've worked in towns, I go to the statutory sort of standard, a planning board, a town meeting can't vote on an item without a planning board public hearing because that's state law. And many, not all, but many communities have boards like our Volunteer Zoning Amendment Committee that vet proposed zoning bylaws, discuss them as to what they think they meant, what they think they're doing, whether it was proposed by the board or by members of the public. And then they give a report to the planning board. The planning board holds a public hearing that they're required to do by state law. And then they issue a determination of what they thought they were doing. And then that goes to the floor of town meeting, and that's debated and it's voted. And I think that to the extent, although I don't necessarily think this is critical, but I think it is illustrative. In this case, I think that the materials that were generated by those boards are very helpful. And one of the elements of it that I think is a really critical element here is to go to the not just the stated purpose, but what exactly happened. And so if you go to, for example, in the town meeting articles, planning board minutes, which ultimately were adopted by town meeting, which is Exhibit M in Crosspoint's filing, it talks about, again, it's the planning board speaking, but I go first to what really happened here, that three things occurred. The title was changed. That goes without question. It went from medical center to health services facility. So that's easy. That's in every set of minutes. That's in town council's analysis of it, and it is in the final determination by the town meeting. So that's number one. I'm going to skip over the changes in the definition, which I think are also absolutely critical, and go to the third element, which is that what this did and didn't do, unless I'm mistaken, and I'm prepared to be informed, there was no zones that a medical center was allowed in that as a result of this it was not allowed, nor any zone that it was allowed by right that it was turned into a special permit. But in fact, in the rural business, the industrial A and the industrial B, a medical center was by special permit, and as a result of the town meeting vote, it was made by right. So I look at that as a zoning attorney as there was at least a demonstrated intent to make something that previously took a discretionary analysis by a planning board or a zoning board of appeals and make it, if you met the state building code, you could just do it. So different people look at that as an upzoning or downzoning, but I, you know, it in other words, it makes it, it opened more parts of the town to use, to have this use in it. So it was not designed to make things more restrictive, but more expansive. So I think that generically, that certainly goes against the concept that there was some suggestion that if that is the leitmotif of the whole thing, that then, but let's make sure that in the downtown business district where there's been a pharmacy for 30 or 40 or 50 years, there was any certainly intentional suggestion that let's tighten this to make that more difficult. In fact, the concept was let's allow it more places. Then if you go to the language, Mr. Chairman, all right, and if you track it, and the changes, all right, the current definition was building that contains establishments suspending health services for health maintenance, stop, and the word and. Then added, okay, remember now we're expanding this but allowing it in more places. the outpatient diagnosis, and then it goes into treatment. So the words, the outpatient diagnosis, so let's see what we think about how that is designed to alter the medical center, and then treatment of medical and physical conditions, including outpatient surgery, and then in the original it said this term, now it says the term, health services facility. Same language, shall not include hospitals. Urgent medical care requiring emergency transportation was added, and everything else is the same. So all of those other discussions, providing support to the medical profession, medical health, dental laboratories, blood banks, and all that, that was already there. Now, none of that was new. So new was outpatient diagnosis and urgent medical care requiring transportation. So why were those added? So then if you go to the minutes of the Zoning Amendment Committee and the minutes of the Planning Board, and you've all read them, but just I think it's important to just to think about it, is that when you see what was discussed at those meetings, all right, and what at least, and counsel for the appellants is correct, that if people thought they were doing something and they did more than they thought, then that's their problem, right? But to determine that that's what occurred, I think you have to look at the overwhelming picture. So if you look at the minutes of the Zoning Amendment Committee and you start to talk about what they were considering, they talked about, you know, the health care services going to be medical centers, and, you know, the chairman of that board, President Selectman, talked about, you know, one of the first items, you know, might lead to some think that hospitals allow, that's not the intention. He noted Zach is recommending opening up the use to be allowed by right in a number of places, and not just industrial A and B, but rural business. Now, rural business is, you know, the Dunkin' Donuts area and all the rest of that. So it's not as if this is like, you know, strip clubs and things like that where you put them in somewhere else. I mean, rural business is the local that's just not in the downtown business. So the area in which this was designed to be opening up is not dramatically different from the downtown business district. So that was that discussion at that time. There was a lot of talk about, you know, wanting to not have overnight stay places, psychiatric care places, things like that, that those should still be out of the thing. Well, if that's the discussion, that's absolutely nothing like the type of delivery of service that we're talking about here. All right, and it went on. We talked about it more than one night. It didn't go on for just once. So it came back. Again, this is one man's position. Mr. Catino stated the main reason for the amendment is to change the term medical care to health services facility. It shouldn't be lost on that really was the primary generator here, because the perception was that phrase, medical center, imparted a very different sort of intention than the much more benign health services facility. So that was all talked about, and that moved forward. Mr. Myres recommended some housekeeping changes in the wording, and they incorporated the Planning Board's previous comments. And so it was voted to send it to town meeting, and in fact it did. So I think that when you look at that background, if there is a question, and I want to speak to it, Mr. Chairman, if I have a moment, that the actual language isn't clear, I think that legislative history is illustrative and makes it, I think, at least helpful to me as a member of this board, that this was not designed to make sort of a sea change in sort of how we were going to approach retail sales as compared to medical facilities or health services facilities, but in fact it was actually to loosen it up, allow it in more zones, but make clear that it wasn't designed by putting it in those zones to allow for overnight stays, for significant diagnostic services. That was designed to be different uses, doctor's offices, things like that. We wanted to make that clear that that wasn't the case. And then if I could have two more minutes, Mr. Chairman.
Certainly.
Your questioning, I think, is also very telling and helpful. If we just look at the words of the bylaw as it exists, and then the third would be the retail question.
Sure.
All right, so it's a building that contains establishments dispensing health service. Now, remember, we're talking about these definitions are definitions of primary uses. Right? So from a zoning perspective, that means that that's supposed to be generically sort of the principal concept of what's supposed to be going on there. So that's what flavors when you read any definition. You're not reading into any definition anything that might sort of fit. You're looking at it, and I believe this is what informs Mr. Cadillac, Mr. Shepherd, in analyzing these, is what's the baseline? So the baseline is, it's the primary, I view, purpose is establishment that dispenses health services, okay? So since this is a definition, it's supposed to be the primary use of that property. And again, I think that counsel for Crosspoint pointed this out, it is that and the outpatient diagnosis and treatment of medical, dental, and physical conditions, including outpatient surgery. So if you look at that as a package, as the chairman pointed out in his questioning, we don't have to wonder about this building because it hasn't been built out. Unless I'm mistaken, and looking at the floor plan and all, this reminds me a lot of the CVS down the street in Ashland, okay? And if it is close, and if I'm wrong, then I'm wrong. I don't see much outpatient diagnosis there. There's certainly no significant treatment of mental. There's certainly no treatment of dental or physical conditions. There's certainly no outpatient surgery. We're talking here that they're not even going to get minute clinics here. So if you look at this as the gloss of the use that's going to occur at this property and the type of use that isn't allowed in the business district, I have a lot of trouble looking at this use as fitting within that definitional framework as a primary use, which I think is what the definitions are designed to do. They can't encapsulate every tiny fraction of what happens, but I think they guide the building officials in determining, you know, a rose is a rose. I know it when I see it. And the last thing I know you hope that I'm going to say relates to this issue of the percentages, okay? And percentages can be helpful in certain contexts. I'm familiar certainly with, let's say, for example, how do you decide if a certain food establishment is a restaurant or a fast food? Because there are those communities that think fast food is bad and shouldn't have certain elements of use and others are good. So if somebody writes a bylaw or an ordinance that says that if a certain percentage of your sales, so now we're talking about all the same thing, how many dollars you give across the counter. Well, that makes sense. That's a good way to analyze it. Is it mostly stuff that people eat there, or is it mostly stuff that people take out? So you don't have to stand and count the people. If at the end of the day, 70% of their receipts every night were people bought a burger or bought a taco or whatever, well, then I think that, you know, people can say that sounds like fast food, okay, because it's apples and apples. All right. Well, I think this is apples and apples. So I don't think that this is an appropriate position to say that even if, and it wasn't demonstrated to me, but even if the position is that the total number of ringing on the register sales at this CVS is going to be 70%. From the registry, the register, let's say, at the back, all right, if you buy all your drugs at the back and you buy your Coca-Cola and your deodorant at the front. From my perspective, that doesn't change because what you're doing in the main, not solely, but in the main, is you or your doctor called in a prescription, and you go in and you pick up a brown jar, and if you've got good insurance, it costs $1, and if you don't, it costs $250. But you just, they put it in a bag, and you swipe your card, and you walk out. The same as if you put two bottles of Coke up at the thing, if you don't want to be healthy, according to Tom Brady, and you swipe your card, and you take your Coke. It's all, as somebody mentioned, it's all a retail sale. Now, that is not to denigrate the education that pharmacists go through, and it's not to suggest that a pharmacist is anything like, no offense to people that have these kids, a clerk who's checking you out, but I'm going to use my life experience to suggest that the overwhelming majority of the revenue that's generated by the pharmacy section is generated by people who walk in and pick up the prescription they already ordered and walk up, the same as if they maybe then stop and pick up some Tylenol. So from my perspective, the 70-30 or 95-5, you know, drugs cost lots more than deodorant. And so it shouldn't at all be surprising that the percentage revenue, even of a modest pharmacy, may, if in fact that's the case, and I don't know that the corporate filing is really representative of what really happens at the CVSs, that's a separate issue, but even if it did, from my perspective, is it's retail sales, and retail sales have been traditionally and always permitted in the downtown business district, and I'm prepared to support the position that, in fact, this is retail sales and support the decision by the building official that the building permit was properly issued. Okay. Thanks for listening such a long time.
I'll make it quick.
Sure.
I just want to...
Unlikely.
I don't have as much to say. I agree this is a statutory construction question more than anything, but I just want to speak to... there was some discussion last week about the changing face of the pharmaceutical industry and being more integrated into healthcare, and I believe that's true. I think some of it may be insurance driven. I know that you know, my personal experience, you know, and I've gone to have a prescription filled at Hopkinton Drug until, you know, my insurance company says no, you need to, there's a generic version of this, you need to go to CVS or someplace else. So there's that piece of it, but also, you know, I looked into this law, this bill that is being proposed in Massachusetts, and this a similar law has been enacted in California and Oregon, and it seems very specific. It doesn't give, you know, broad authority to pharmacists to give diagnosis, and it's really very specific. And I don't know all the details, and I was hoping that somebody here could enlighten me, but it talks about collaborative. One piece of it is collaboration with medical professionals, and it seems like it's an extra step that the pharmacist has to take to gain that. And it also talks about being able to prescribe the oral contraceptives and the nicotine drugs for people who want to quit smoking. And those are not diagnoses. To buy a nicotine drug, all you have to do is be a smoker. I don't think it takes a doctor's prescription to obtain a medicine like that. So. And further, this law hasn't been enacted in Massachusetts yet, so I guess I'm not willing to make the jump to say that a pharmacist falls within that realm.
Did more research than I did, so thank you.
I guess, you know, to give my thoughts on this, I don't want to belabor any of the points that everyone else made. I particularly agree with most of what you said, Mike, and... I won't identify which parts I specifically may take issue with, but you know, I think coming into this, you know, I certainly a good number of people within the town feel strongly about this position, and I think they've you know, they've done a good job of making sure that their position gets heard and that this issue gets brought to us. I commend the advocates on both sides for their presentations. I thought those were great, too. They really developed the points, developed the evidence, and gave us a lot to chew on. You know, I've commented a few times in this that this is a legal appeal, and it's on legal issues. I think, for me personally, you know, if this were being presented to us on different standards, if this were a special permit or variance where we had a wide amount of discretion to make our decision, I might feel differently about this. But you know, we're confined to the legal issues that are presented here in the appeal and by the owners with respect to standing. And I think on that point, you know, I agree with Mike that the intent of this change to health service facility was clearly not to sweep in something that's been a long-term pre-existing use across the street, essentially, into something that would be non-conforming. I think both mics are on, are correct in that. You know, do I think that pharmacists at the CVS will never provide health services? No, I don't think that. I think there are some health services that will be provided in the course of operations at the CVS, but do those, you know, some of them have been spoken about with vaccinations and the like, but do those aspects that will be health services transform this whole use and this whole facility into a health services facility per se? And I have to say no, that they don't. I think, you know, there's retail use going on in the front of the house. There's retail use going on in the back of the house. There's in the pharmacy, there's probably going to be some health services that are associated with that, but they're not the principal focus. You know, the fact that this definition chose the title health services facility when before it was something else, I don't think that, as one of the commenters pointed out earlier today in the public hearing, I don't think just because there's a health service provided somewhere in a facility that transforms the facility into something that fits within this definition. As I said, I might Monday morning quarterback a little bit on how the definition was phrased in some aspects, but you know, I think when you look at it as a whole, it seems to me pretty clear that on the legal issues presented, that this the use that CVS is going to have, that Crosspoint has defended on behalf of its tenant, is not going to fall within the definition of the health services facility here. That's on the merits. I think we've already spoken all about how we feel about allowing the appellants in. So I don't think I need to say anything more about that. But, I commend everyone who stepped up to raise this issue that they felt strongly about, to give it a hearing and to let us make the determination. It's great that there's folks who are passionate about what happens in the town, and I hope that continues. And that's where I'm at. So I think we may be ready for a motion, unless anyone has more to add.
Chris, let me ask a question. What's your preference in terms of, does it make a difference? I've seen it done both ways. I've seen a motion to approve the appeal and to determine if that gets four votes. And I've seen a motion to deny. Do you feel there's a clear way to do it?
I don't have a preference of my own. I think if my memory serves, the last time I was here with this board, the way it was framed was that there was a motion to deny the appeal and therefore
affirm the determination of the building commission. That was sort of stated both ways, but make perfectly clear what you're doing.
Okay. I didn't know if you thought there was a difference with that actual distinction or not. So, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to move to deny the appeal and as a result uphold the decision of the building official to grant the building permit for the build-out of the former Coletta site for CVS.
Okay, and is that with reference to the findings that you just described and we all did, I believe?
Yes.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second that motion.
Okay. Any discussion further? In that case, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No opposed? And that with a vote of 5-0, the motion carries, and the building inspector's, assistant building inspector's decision is upheld. So, thank you, everyone. We do have one more matter, so I understand some folks may want to move on. But let's take 1 minute to let everyone who wishes to leave move. Ladies and gentlemen, then, with that, let us turn to our fourth and final matter for the night, 59 Wood Street, the continued public hearing for the Learning Center of Hopkinton.
Open but never really went through.
Right, and I do believe we properly opened it and continued with requests. So, please present your case.
Thank you. Members of the board. I know it's late. Hopefully our appeal doesn't take as long as your last one. My name is Suzette Ferreira. I'm here with Trish Miller, who is the executive director and owner of the Learning Center, which she has been operating here in Hopkinton for the last 15 years. We're here tonight because my client received a cease and desist order because she was using the child care facility to host children's birthday parties. The cease and desist letter goes on to state that there are businesses that specifically host parties for children, and there is no evidence that a party center is a proper and customary accessory use to a child care center. As the board is aware, an accessory use is allowed under the residence B zone, and it is our position that hosting birthday parties is an accessory use with a daycare facility. With respect to the letter, I actually do not believe that there are any businesses that specifically host just birthday parties for children. And I actually can't specifically think of any locally or anywhere close to this area. In fact, I believe that hosting birthday parties is usually, almost always, an accessory use to the primary use of the business. For example, birthday parties are hosted and organized usually at dance centers, gymnastic centers, bowling alleys, ice rinks,
and other sports centers. And in all of these types of scenarios, the birthday party is only an accessory use and not the primary use of that business. In preparing for tonight's hearing, I actually reviewed case law as well as the town bylaws, and I found that the town bylaw is pretty consistent with case law in defining and determining what an accessory use is. An accessory use is incidental and subordinate to the principal use of the business. It's located on the same lot of the principal use or building. The accessory use cannot be the primary use, and it has a reasonable relationship with the primary use, and it is usual to maintain in connection with the primary use of that lot. A daycare or preschool is basically caring for a child or children. A lot of times the supervisors at that daycare are usually trained in CPR and in first aid. So what I would like to do is show you how birthday parties are an accessory use to a daycare facility. Both birthday parties and daycare facilities have to do with children and supervising children. It involves doing activities that are already part of the daycare curriculum. I did print out some printouts from my client's website that shows that she actually offers a number of different of type of activities, enrichment type of programs, including karate, yoga. She does a tumble bus. She brings in music people into the daycare to put on music shows. She brings in animals to put in animal shows. And she does all kinds of activities. I don't know if the board wants copies of these that I could provide.
If you'd like to hand them up, we'll have a look. Please get one to there.
That's right.
Thank you.
So at both daycare parties, the children would pick one of these activities. A lot of times these are the same children that are already going to these centers. These children would be supervised by the same adults and teachers that are already supervising them during the daycare business hours. The kids would then perform this activity in the supervision of the teachers, and then after that they would have a snack just like they do when they're in daycare. And if it's during lunch, they would have lunch, would be pizza or something else, and they would have cake. So all of that type of stuff is already done in the daycare. My client currently has approximately 153 students attending the daycare facility. They currently have birthday parties during the day. With that amount of students, she could probably have two birthday parties a week just celebrating the children's birthday parties within the school, during the school time, already having cake during the school time. And as a mother, and I'm sure most of you are parents, and I would feel more comfortable leaving my child at a daycare for a birthday party, probably more so than I would leaving them anywhere else, because I know that they're being left with teachers that have experience with a lot of children. They're trained in CPR, they're trained in first aid, and I know that would be a safe environment. Obviously, the primary business of my client is a daycare. But at the same time, it's the same thing. Supervising children, doing activities with children, having the same type of programs that she already offers. She's not proposing any new types of activities. Providing food that she's already providing at the school, where a lot of these other places like a dance center or a gymnastic center, they don't have food when your kid or child goes in for a dance class. They're not providing any type of food. Yet, they do birthday parties there. Birthday parties are not a noxious activity. It's related to the primary use of the daycare. The same adults are caring for these children. They are doing the same activities. It is our position that this use is reasonably related. It's subordinate to the primary use. It's located in the same buildings as the current daycare is located. It's not an overburden to the site. It's not expanding the site in any way. And we're asking the board tonight to find that this providing birthday parties is an accessory use that would be allowed under the zoning. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Council. Any questions from the board? John?
So is the question that is the differentiation between the current, in other words, if you had a birthday party for a current student and separation is that this is perhaps inviting anybody out from the public that could have host a birthday party at your site at
yes.
the school.
Yes, that's correct. Obviously, because of the amount of children that already attend this daycare facility, most of the children that would be having parties at the facility would be from the daycare, but obviously if they hear, oh, we can have a birthday party at TLC now, it's going to be open to everyone and not just the children of the daycare center, so yes.
So is that all?
That was pretty much my question. This is a service offered to the public, advertised to the public, and not restricted to the enrollees of the daycare center.
I think it would be difficult to restrict it because if you have a birthday party for a child at the daycare center and they invite other children that do not attend the daycare center and then those children want to have parties, it would be difficult to say, oh, I'm sorry, no, we can't provide this service for you because you don't currently attend my daycare. That would almost be worse, saying that, no, you have to attend my daycare in order to be able to have a party. So, no, it would be open to the public.
So someone that has no previous relationship with the daycare center can book a party?
Yes. Yes.
My daughter attended a party at a daycare center years ago. It was the Next Generation, other one in Hopkinton. And I guess my question is, how common is it? Do you have a sense of how many daycares provide this sort of use?
Honestly, my client actually always thought it was a permitted use. This is actually not anything new. She's actually always been providing these birthday parties for the last 15 years. She was unaware that it wasn't an allowed use as part of the daycare. So as to whether other daycare facilities do the same thing, I don't know. But obviously, you just mentioned that Next Generation is another daycare facility that does allow the same thing. So I would assume that there are quite a few that do offer that type of service as well.
Before we get to you, since we have another associate back up, if you have any questions.
I didn't like this. Question my mind was, they had me a birthday party, but then you lost me and you talked about people coming in from outside. What's the criteria for letting somebody come in from outside and have a party there?
I would think anybody would come in because it would be difficult to restrict them. It would.
If you guess come from outside, or is it just a kid's
event? No. Yes. Again, that would be something hard to restrict, to tell your children that they can have a birthday party there, but they can only invite children that attend the daycare facility.
Sure. No thought.
Do the parties take place during the business hours of the daycare, or are they on Saturdays?
They would like to have the parties on Saturdays, on Sundays, half days at school, holidays, if there's a Friday holiday or Monday holiday, or after hours as well, yes.
So it would be when there's full attendance at the daycare?
Correct.
And I'm sure we're going to want to hear from staff. you indicated, Council, that these parties have been operating for some period of time?
Yes, my client tells me she's actually been doing it for since 2003.
2000,
since she opened the facility, yes.
Does she have a sense, you heard the percentage discussion earlier.
I did.
Does she have a sense of, generically over this period, what percentage of the birthday child, not the attendees, was a student at the center as compared to people just seeing an ad and saying, that sounds like a great idea?
Should I answer that? Most of them are children that attend the center or friends or relatives of those children who attend the center.
So percentage-wise, what would you say between students and non-students?
90% students.
Is it the case in terms of the, you said in your presentation that these parties could actually occur then during the school day?
No, what I was saying is right now, if it's a student's birthday, I'm sure that they're having just with the students that are there they're celebrating that child's birthday. So it's not an actual birthday party, but they do already celebrate birthdays in the center, not have an actual party.
Does the operator bring in different employees to handle the weekend parties, or they're the same people that handle the children during the week?
They are the same teachers and employees that currently work at the center.
Just may I go off council for a second?
Sure, sure.
Chuck or Mike, how did this come about to become discovered if it had been occurring for so many years?
We saw it on the internet. News. We're on the internet.
Let the record indicate that it was happening.
The smart sites that they sell bitcoins and all that.
Not that this turns on this, but so you're suggesting that this was not the result of a complaint, but it was a result of.
Well, I can't really call it. We got a call from somebody else who does daycare, who says how can
they do it and why can't I?
I mean, that's the way.
So it's a little competition. Okay. Council, the one thing that I would be interested in, and it's a follow-up from one of the questions, is that you were making a suggestion, an argument, and you had a couple good quotes on one of the times, that this seems to be as you know, as an attorney, an accessory use is generally viewed as customary and usual in connection with a particular operation. My thinking would be that it's not whether it's customary or usual for your client's operation, but as some of you just mentioned, is it customary and usual in general for this type of use in this type of general area? You indicated you didn't know, you thought it might be. It would help me come to a conclusion about this, maybe not everybody else, if there could be, remember when we did Water Fresh and all that, there was a lot of talk about whether or not in the use that they had, could they add other things, and you know, it's the classic accessory use analysis, and it's evolutionary. Something that was not customary and usual 40 years ago could be every day of the day, and I think that building officials and such need to take that, you know, into consideration. So it would help me understand if, whether I'm not just saying any other daycare in Hopkinton, but generally is this the kind of thing? And as a follow-up from that, how is this use categorized in this zone? Is it a by right use? Is it Dover use? Is it under the state statute of... Okay, so it's the standard daycare exemption under 48.3. Okay, be located anywhere, and be regulated in terms of parking and safety and all the rest of that, how many kids, and it's licensed, as you point out, so it's teachers-to-student ratio and all those things. You have all the licenses, et cetera.
Yes.
I apologize for not having driven by it. Is it in a residence zone? Is it a business zone? I apologize for not knowing.
I believe it is a residence zone, but it's surrounded by all businesses.
I'm actually not sure anymore. It used to be...
It was a private residence, probably maybe 10 years ago, and it was converted to the school. There are three residences across the street in the vicinity. Elmwood School is east of this location. And there's a church to the west of this location on the same side of the street. As Chuck pointed out, when we saw the advertisement, it just seemed to be kind of a separate piece from the school. And I only mean that because the abutters, they all went to the site plan review, or at least had the opportunity when the school was in there, and talked about parking and traffic and all that stuff. There was no discussion at that time. We may entertain having parties on Saturdays and Sundays. So without the benefit of the neighbors knowing this business was going to happen, this was a format that I thought the discussion could ensue. I have no way of knowing whether a party center is an accessory use to a daycare. So my kids and grandkids have gone to a lot of parties, Chuck and Cheese, I don't rename all of them, the gymnastics place. They drive all their friends along the car shop lot. That's the way it is. But when I read this, and I saw it was a very creative idea. The educational component was really great. They had like four or five different themes they could pick.
Yeah.
It all sounded really cool for a parent to get a really successful birthday party for their child. The problem I had was, I had no problem at all with it happening during the course of the school day, because you could say it's part of school. Where a kid gets a cupcake because he turned four. And that's understandable. This was different. This was open to the rest of the public, not just the school children. It was broadcast so that everybody could see it and advertised. So I thought that it was important enough for the board to consider whether or not those proper accessory use.
I appreciate that, and that's very helpful for me.
Nothing more?
Nothing more right now.
With that reservation. I think from my perspective, one thing I was troubled by in, and this is in the papers, I believe the website printouts, with respect to the parties, I understand it fits in rather well, whether it's a proper accessory use or not, it fits in rather well to have kids' parties, birthday parties, very typical. It's the same population you're serving as a school. But there was a page that suggested that in addition to birthday parties, you'd host yoga events, milestone parties, bridal showers, almost any event.
No, that's not me.
This is a TLC Party Central page.
Bridal showers?
That's what it said.
That's totally not me.
Well, whether it's you or not, I think my one concern I have is if the scope of what you're asking for is beyond kids' parties, I think it's
not
a different discussion.
It is not.
Absolutely. I don't know where that came from.
Okay.
Could I just take a look at that after,
sure,
just so I can see
sure
it?
Sure. I think there was just a copy in the file, so. Yeah. It's the second page to what's in the materials we got. Same style as this, but a couple more pages. I think so, yeah.
I couldn't possibly.
It's the second, the bottom of those two.
The second one?
That was just in the name.
I know nothing about it. It's just children's birthday parties.
Oh, yeah, right here. I see.
I have no idea where that came from.
Yeah.
So I think then, if I understand you correctly, you'd be comfortable that if that's part of the website and that it's certainly not something you want to offer or are currently offering. And
right, that's beyond the scope. The
right.
Scope would be just to be offering the children's birthday parties and nothing else.
Well, then with the hope that you'll take a quick peek and make sure it's not, you're not advertising something beyond.
I know that I've had a right to be doing the parties,
yeah.
So we closed it down the minute I got the letter.
As soon as she received the cease and desist, she took everything off the website. She stopped hosting the parties until
before
this board.
As you should have, and that's great. If I could just have that one back to the file, if you don't mind. For what it's worth. That's all right. I think, with the representation, that's not what you're asking for. I think we can confine it a little bit better to this, because that had initially troubled me. I think I did a little looking myself, and which is always dangerous, but I did find that while there are at least some daycare centers that offer this sort of service. There's Bright Horizons that's in Sudbury, and they have a couple of other locations that they advertise what seems like very much the same kind of kind of thing with themed, you know, themed parties for kids, and this is beyond the kids in the center. I saw some, you know, elsewhere. So I think I would probably characterize what I did in my very cursory look at this as it seems to be certainly the minority of daycare centers that have this sort of associated party business with them, but it's certainly known. Now, whether that satisfies an accessory use, I'm not sure. I guess I'd have a question. I'll ask this of council first and then of staff, but you know, when with a Dover use, is an accessory use still permitted for a Dover use? This may have come up previously, as you said, with you know, with Waterfresh, but what's your view on that? Given that, you know, this isn't an otherwise permitted use within this residential B zone.
So I guess I would look at that as being a permitted use because through the Dover Act is permitted in whatever type of area. So therefore, what do we have to look at to see what else is included within that? I think we'd have to go back to the resident B zone, and as part of the resident B zone, an accessory use is included as part of an allowed use. So I would say that if it's an accessory use, that it would still be allowed.
Would you?
But obviously.
Would you disagree with me that, I guess my, as I said, cursory look, that it does seem to be, while these services are offered with other daycare facilities, it seems to be in the minority?
You know, I think you brought up a good point earlier. I think as things evolve, I think daycare centers have evolved immensely. Just even looking at the types of programs that are offered through the Learning Center, I think it's a lot different than what you see in other types of daycares and schools, because she is offering yoga and karate and she's bringing all these things. Not every daycare center does that. So I think it's like you said earlier, we have to evolve with the times. And to me personally, it almost makes more sense to have a daycare center provide birthday parties rather than a dance center, because you are really doing almost the same exact thing that you do during the day for a daycare center rather than a dance center. A dance center, you go to a dance class, you leave. You don't eat there, you never have cake there, there's no food there. Whereas a daycare center, they're already providing food, they're already providing cake, they're already doing all of these things. And the fact that now they're providing these types of programs, it makes sense to be able to provide birthday parties on the weekends. And I think parents, it's a more security, I think, for a parent to leave their child in a daycare center, especially if your child already goes there. You already know the teachers. You don't have to worry about another parent's going to be watching your children, or you're going to have, you know, younger girls that teach a dance class watching your children. So I think maybe it may not be extremely popular, but I do think it's evolving, and I do think you're going to see it more in some of these daycare centers that are providing a lot more for the children.
And as I said, I think the educational focus to the party side is also ties it fairly well to the primary use in my mind. I guess on the issue of Dover and accessory, do you guys agree that you just treat it as a permitted use in the zone and then accessories are allowed?
It is more in a non-residential area, you know, this accessory use type thing on nights, weekends. That's
my opinion. Yeah, I mean, I have concerns about the time and in that too, but Mike.
If you're picking up on what you're saying, I tend to agree with council that if you look at a Dover protected use as under the statute, that is a permitted use in every zone, then it's the equivalent of a single family house in a single family zone. So I tend to agree. I very much so pick up on your position. Happily, it's the way it was presented to us as opposed to making it up here. From what I understand, that it is themed. I don't want to speak for the owner, but I would say that it is obviously designed to use the space that they're already paying for to get a benefit out of it. It's like being open on a day that you own your business and you're paying your lease, and why not make money that day? It is also advertising of the value of the services, because it seems to me as the testimony is, it's the same teachers, it's the same people. So if a parent or something or their child really loved that and said, you really like Mrs. Jones and Mrs. Smith, and oh yeah, she was super, that's the same person they'd get if they enrolled. So that makes sense. And as you point out, Mr. Chairman, as it's themed, it's not just go around, run around like nuts and Chuck E. Cheese.
Right.
It's not Chuck E. Cheese, at least the way it's been presented. I don't know what the pleasure of the board is here. You know, there are two ways to handle, if there was any incentive, if there's any sense of the board to work to approve this, and I don't know if there is. But if there were, and from my perspective there is, I would like to see the applicant and the council sort of prepare a proposed set of conditions, picking up on what we are talking about, as opposed to having us sit here for and spend a lot of time. If the sense of the committee is, the board is, that might help advance their likelihood, I think it would respond to some of what Mike is saying. It might enable you to distinguish yourself. And the reason I'm saying this is because you were busted and you're not sort of making up what you'd like to do. I'm taking you as your words that this is the way you've already done it. And that means a great deal to me about that, in the sense that this was part of your business plan. Yes, it's part of your business plan. You're trying to make a living. You're trying to use the space that you're already paying for. But you're keying it to what you're doing during the week. And that means, I won't speak for everybody, but that means a lot to me from my perspective. I could be more inclined to support this if I saw a presentation for things like numbers, hours, you know, like, remember what we did when we did this, Chuck and Mike and all, and we dealt with the water fresh for the weddings and the things, and it was all only so many hours, only so many this. Remember that, Elaine? And it was all very carefully crafted to ensure that it did fit with their overall, you know, the fresh food and the whole thing. It was accessory, and that is what it was all about. It was all key to that. And so the more, from my perspective, the more it was finely tuned, designed, and therefore the ads didn't talk about bridal showers, but key to the actual business plan that you've suggested is what you want to do. That would mean, from my perspective, speaking for only as one of five, that would mean something to me. I would also be interested if, even though it may not be determinative, if you could make some effort to determine generically what occurs. And in fact, even if what you show occurs but is nothing like yours, it is just come one, come all, and play in the ball pit, which I think would also help me distinguish what you're attempting to do in terms of it being a learning experience, mm-hmm. As well as, you know, a fun experience and a good use. And it's a little bit like daycare. The parents can bring their kids and they can drop them off on a weekend. Maybe they'd like to do something on a weekend as opposed to the week when they just go to work.
Right. We would be more than willing to try to draft something, get it to the board before a next hearing so you do have time to review it.
Yeah, there's...
I think that would be my preference too, because I agree. I'm minded. Yeah, it does make sense, and you know, I'm mindful that this is something you were doing for close to 15 years, it seems, and you know, I will commend, you know, the inspectors for, you know, for calling it out, because I think they did have a fair reason to raise a concern here, but you know, I wouldn't also want to overturn their decision and say anything goes.
Mm-hmm.
And
without question.
Yeah. So if you're willing to, you know, to put the conditions together rather than have us try and do it on the fly, I think that would, with apologies to delaying you a bit longer to getting a resolution here, I think that would be.
It's also easier to edit than
start from scratch.
Create. And blank is paper to create your business plan for you. That's, I'm not interested in doing.
Do we want to
verify the dates and just discuss the deadlines?
Yeah. So I have the sense that a continuance will be requested, but since we've noticed and we are having the public hearing, I think we've gotten done with counsel for the moment. I'd like to open up to, as I see a few other people here, to other comments from the public.
Scott Richardson, president of the Hoppington Chamber of Commerce. I was just made aware of this cease and desist, and certainly I understand where the building inspector, you know, has concerns over, well, we didn't know this was going on. But I think in hearing what I've heard, and obviously what you've heard, that this accessory use has been, it sounds like an accessory use to me, but leave that to your decision and them to define it. But certainly if it's been an ongoing operation for 10 plus years, it seems a simple matter to be able to define it more specifically and be able to support, you know, a business that is, you know, providing great service to our community and, again, is looking to expand that. So
thank you.
Yeah, I think my concern would be that there are a lot of daycare centers in residential neighborhoods, at least one of which was the subject of a rather bitter legal fight near me. But it is I was in no way involved, but, you know, it is a sensitive subject in neighborhoods and, you know, as far as, you know, extra noise and traffic, you know, in areas where, you know, people expect it to just have a residential use. So, I mean, this location may be different, you know, we take it one by one, but, you know, my concern is that, you know, other people will want to do it too, and how are we, you know, going to handle that?
I would agree, and I think we will have to look carefully, and inspectors will have to look carefully at others if this is presented, and make sure that as those businesses want to operate or are operating, that it is subordinate and minor in significance. I mean, I didn't ask the question, although I can. I mean, my sense is, given that I know the expense of daycare, that the party business, when it was operating, was probably, again, a percentage issue, but probably a small percentage of your overall revenues.
Very small. I don't know if I break even, so.
Fair enough. Does introduce people
it
to
does.
You.
It brings the center into the community, and it brings more people to the center, and consequently, it brings me children. So.
Right, but I would distinguish that from a daycare that's serving 150-ish kids on a regular basis and has a few parties, in addition to, you know, a daycare center that might be home-based that's serving five or six in a residential area, and all of a sudden has 50 parties a week.
Right.
I think, you know, we'd have to look at it on a case-by-case basis to make sure it's properly an accessory. But
sure.
Yeah.
So that should be something that you would think about. You know, we talked about the, you know, the water fresh thing and like that, and we took a lot of effort to make sure that we believed that their use of that was going to be clearly accessory, clearly minimal, and you know, just supported the overall business as opposed to became the business.
Right.
And so that's the more that you can tailor that, the more likely is you might get the votes you need.
Sure. And I think once you see what she has been doing, it will become more clear that it's not going to be detrimental. It's not going to be, you know, a lot of increased traffic, especially on the weekends. There's more traffic trying to get your child in and out in the morning or at the end of the day than there is to bring, you know, 10 kids to a birthday party on the weekend.
Yeah, well, that's why so knowing the numbers, knowing the time, knowing the limitations,
right.
As a proposal would, you know, at least help some of us possibly.
I think so, yeah. All right, then I've got one public comment. Just as there still are other people who have been very patiently waiting through the whole evening, I just want to make sure if anyone else had anything to chime in with, they're welcome to. But otherwise, I'll
support for her.
Great. Otherwise, I'll commend your endurance.
For the record, Mr. Chairman, I've met Trish, although we don't hang out together. I don't think it's altered my ability. I think we've all, if we live and work in the town, we've often met or seen more than one person that's come before us. But I have no financial interest in her center, and in fact, until tonight, I had no idea what she did. But I don't know. I just wanted to say that, and I don't have any little children, so I would never have any need to know. All right. When are we next up?
We're scheduled on 10/28, and then the following week on 11/4, because November 1st and 3rd Wednesday is the holiday. Mm. We have nothing scheduled from now at all, so I plan not to have on any meetings, so it's up to you guys. You know, they're back to back. It's the last week of October, the first week of November. The whole schedule, we can do the last week of October and then cancel the first week of November's hearing.
Oh, they both on by?
Yeah.
I have my own opinion, but what does everybody else think? I'll just go with the group.
I'm going to. This is culture.
So you prefer not the 4th?
The 28th. I mean, I think the 28th would work for me, too, and that would minimize the length of time we're...
Can we go first?
You're the only one. You can go first.
I already have everything all done anyway, so...
Is that the 28th pleasure? Would work for us. We would try to get something to the board sooner
I'll do
than
it
that.
Okay.
Then I'll do it in October. Maybe we need November to have more.
Then, loading in October 28. I would ask council if you would sign the continuance. So we have it for the file, and then we will open and take your submissions in 2 weeks.
Yeah, as in advance, as much as is appropriate. Okay, so we have a chance to think about it. Hate the stuff that comes in the night more.
All right, then I think we have wrapped for this one. Since we have a request for a continuance, I'd entertain a motion to continue until October 28th.
I move it.
I hear a motion. I hear a second. No discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed. So unanimously move to continue. And that, I think, brings us to the end of this.
Adjourn.